The community calendar is produced by members of the KPFA Apprenticeship Program. Send your listing at least 3 weeks in advance to KPFA Box 51, 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley, California, 94704. Fax them to 510-848-3812 or email us at calendar@kpfa.org. Attention to the community calendar. Tell us if your event is wheelchair accessible. To hear this calendar again, call 510-848-6767, extension 621. This calendar is also online at kpfa.org.
You're listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, or KFCF in Fresno, or on the web at kpfa.org. It's 7:01. Up next, Full Circle. Stay with us.
Full circle, yes, we rotate 360 degrees. Ha ha, 360 degrees. Ha ha, 306, 306, 360 degrees. Ha ha.
Welcome to Full Circle, your cultural affairs radio magazine produced by apprentices of the First Voice Media Action Program. On tonight's show, you will hear about the execution of Stanley Tookie Williams,
the story of a young woman recently released from state prison,
an interview with Mumia Abu-Jamal covering the Johannes Mezrahi trial,
and finally, a commentary from our own Joy Moore on the injustice of the prison industrial complex.
And tonight on the mics, you have Chago and Shayna. Stay with us.
Welcome, everyone, to Full Circle. Tonight's show, you will get into the stories, perspectives, and realities around one of the most lucrative industries in the nation, the prison industry.
On April 11, 1878, the first recorded execution in California took place in San Diego County. Four Native Americans were found guilty of conspiracy to murder and were executed by a firing squad.
By 1967, 709 executions had taken place in California by firing squad, hanging, and the gas chamber. But in 1972, and again in 1976, the California Supreme Court decided that the death penalty was unconstitutional and took almost 175 people off death row and resentenced them.
The statute was quickly reversed, and in 1977, the death penalty was reinstated. Since then, 13 people have been executed in California, the most recently a Native American.
Tonight, our own Free Will in Franklin brings us the story of Stanley Tookie Williams, the 12th person executed since the reinstatement of the death penalty. As a young man, Tookie was a gang leader. But Tookie grew up to be a children's author and a noteworthy peacemaker. In 2004, he helped broker a famous peace agreement between the Bloods and the Crips, just 1 year before he was executed.
As many of our regular KPFA listeners may remember, on December 13th in the year 2005, the state of California executed Stanley Tookie Williams at San Quentin Prison. Although convicted of multiple murders, Tookie, as he was known, claimed his innocence till the end, which some may argue helped seal his fate, because Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger said, quote, "Without an apology and atonement for these senseless and brutal killings, there can be no redemption," unquote. Others may argue differently, saying his work towards peace on the streets made him a threat to the prison industrial complex. KPFA did two separate live broadcasts from the gates of San Quentin. The first took place on November 19, 2005, at a rally on Tookie's behalf, dubbed Save the Peacemaker, derived from the Protocol for Peace, a manual written by Tookie for street gangs to bring peace to their own streets and to stop the killings between rival gangs. Within this Protocol for Peace, were chapters titled Gang Member Renunciation, Establishing and Maintaining Peace, and A Social Agenda for Peacekeepers. This was a manual that could be used worldwide. Let's listen as the rap giant Snoop Dogg speaks at the event.
What's happening, y'all? What's happening? Yeah. I know a lot of y'all know how I get out as far as with the music thing and movies and TV or whatnot, but today I'm out here on a whole different path.
That's you know what
I'm
saying?
Now, what I want to say is that, you know, I come from Eastside Long Beach, home of where gangbanging is an all-time must, and Crippin' is at an all-time high. And I was once a Crip gang member. And, you know, through my growing up in this music game, I learned how to better control myself and better control my attitude. And once I got a chance to see the movie Redemption, you know what I'm saying, starring Jamie Foxx, good thing he had me come down there to the premiere to see it because I knew nothing about it. Once I seen that movie, it drew me more intact with what I really needed to be doing. That was contacting the kids and touching the people in the community. And what was so crazy was that I didn't get this from somebody that was on the streets. I didn't get this from my father or an uncle. I got this from Stanley Tookie Williams, a brother that was locked up on death row. He inspired me to want to do something positive with my life and to go touch them kids and to really be in their face and not just send an autograph or act like I was going to show up, but really come to the place and show up and touch hands with the people. So I want to say to you, Governor, that Stanley Tookie Williams is not just a regular old guy. He's an inspirator. He inspires me, and I know I inspire millions. So if he's inspiring me and I inspire millions, you add that up. That's over 100 million people that's inspired by what he do.
The next month, December 13th, thousands gathered once again to hold a vigil through the long night of his execution, and KPFA was there. At that gathering, young people read excerpts from some of his children's books.
Being a gangbanger is no fun. It's no fun being a gangbanger. Gangbangers are always looking behind the shoulders because they're afraid someone may hurt them. Gangbangers also worry about getting caught by the police for doing bad things like stealing. Many gangbangers are scared all the time, but they won't tell anyone because they want their homeboys to think they're down. It's truly no fun being a gangbanger.
Friendship and power. We spend a lot of time with our friends. We tell our secrets to our friends. We share our lunch money and candy and clothes with our friends. We count on our friends to make us feel better when we're afraid or angry or sad. We really trust our friends. We listen to them. We worry about what they think of us. We want them to like us. For all these reasons, we give our friends a lot of power over us. That is why it's important for you to pick true friends to hang out with. We're your friends.
An important lesson. Many of my homeboys have killed. It feels terrible, but I've learned something important. When you use violence to boss other kids around or to make what doesn't belong to you, you're really not proving that you're strong or tough. If you thought you were strong, you could tell your homeboys the truth about how you feel. You can admit to them when you're scared. You could say no to violence, and you would not let any homeboy push you into doing something that you know is wrong.
With Dana Granby on Full Circle in 2002, this is what Tookie had to say about his books.
The books in itself is, I consider it to be more of a caveat, something to warn children about, because I've experienced this madness and I know what they're heading for if they end up traveling down the path that I have. Throughout those books, I warned them about gangs, I warned them about drugs, weapons, and things of that nature. And my main objective is for them to obtain an education. Because once they start going to a juvenile hall, they'll end up being in CYA, then prison, then before they know it, they'll end up on death row, like a lot of these youngsters are. So it's more of a warning that this isn't the type of life they want to experience. Actually, it is no life, being in prison.
As the night wore on, the waiting to hear the news went well after the 12:01 scheduled execution time.
Friends, I know you're anxious to get news. We all are. We don't know what's going on. We can't find out. We are waiting to get answers. The process sometimes, this is very sad and grim. It can take 10, 15, 20 minutes for an execution to be completed. So please, take a deep breath. Please be patient. We may not find out for another 15 or 20 minutes what's going on. And so we have to be calm, and we have to be reflective, and we have to listen to Stan's words. As soon as we know anything, we will let you know.
I'm Greg Bridges along with Amelia Gonzalez, and we are coming to you live from the gates of San Quentin. Well, right now we're in the company of thousands of people, thousands who are waiting to hear word of the execution of Stanley Tookie Williams. The execution was scheduled for a minute after midnight, and we are now in the 27th minute of this new day.
Finally, the word came from KPFA's Max Pringle, reporting from inside the prison.
State of California has indeed executed Stanley Tookie Williams. The time, unofficial, is 12:35 Pacific time. We're awaiting a final word from the warden, Steve Aronofsky, to give us the final statement of Stanley Tookie Williams, if indeed there was one. The lethal injection was administered a little bit past midnight, and there were 39 witnesses to the execution, 5 of whom were invitees of Williams, 5 were family members. Of the 4 people, Williams was convicted of slaying in 1981. The rest were prison officials and media. Williams' remains will be taken to the Marin County Coroner's Office, where an unnamed family member will claim them, along with his possessions. Again, 51-year-old Stanley Tookie Williams, who gained international notoriety for a prison conversion, gang leader to peacemaker, is now dead. San Quentin State Prison, I'm Max Pringle.
Well, thank you, Max Pringle.
Tookie Williams was the 12th man put to death by California since capital punishment was revived in 1992 after a quarter-century hiatus, followed by Clarence Ray Allen, a 76-year-old Choctaw Indian sick with diabetes. And finally, the killings were ground to a halt on February 21, 2006, when the prison could not find no doctor willing to operate the instruments of death to end the life of Michael Morales, and the execution was stayed over a constitutional challenge. Some say if Williams was never locked up, would he have had his great transformation into redemption, or would he be another victim of the streets? That will be for you to decide. I leave you lastly with these words from Tookie, stating why he should be granted clemency and what he would do if he was.
First and foremost, I would have to say that I am innocent. I've been saying that from the incipient of my arrest. And secondly, I will say if I'm allowed to live, if Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger grants me a clemency or an indefinite stay, it will also enable me to continue to disseminate my positive message to youth and adults. And last but not least, a clemency would, in a sense, allow me to inevitably prove my innocence. And also, I might say that I won't be just resting on my laurels or anything like that. Just recently, I had the opportunity to meet vis-a-vis, face-to-face, with the president and CEO of the NAACP, Bruce Gordon. And what emanated from that particular meeting was a partnership. And what that entails is that we're going to create a violence prevention curriculum for at-risk youth throughout America and abroad. So my life will not just be sitting inertia in a prison cell. I will actually be, as I'm doing now, but on a higher scale, I'll be able to reach not just thousands, but hopefully millions of youth, and help to reverse this cycle of madness.
Reverse the cycle of madness. That was the voice of 6-time Nobel Peace Prize nominee Stanley Tookie Williams from an interview with KPFK's Jasmine Kanick, speaking before his execution December 2005. Before we go, let's not forget, although Tukey claims his innocence, there are still victims in his case. Let's not forget to remember all the victims of gang violence, and not only hope for a day when this violence will cease, but work towards that end whenever we can. For Full Circle, this is Free Will in Franklin.
Thank you, Franklin, for that story of Tukey Williams and his 2005 execution in San Quentin State Correctional Facility. To learn more, the 4th Annual Stanley Tukey Williams Legacy Summit is coming up, Mobilizing the Movement for Justice, which is taking place at Merritt College this Sunday, December 13th at 3 p.m. For more information, call 510-235-9780. Up next, we'll hear a song called Free by The Frontline, The Soul Snatchers, Rico Pavón, and Cam. This song was created to help support the movement to save Tukey before his execution.
And I want to say of the brother that he touched me deeply. I never met him before. I didn't know of his past life. But I learned of him that the man that I met at San Quentin is as far removed from the man that was Stan Tukey Williams, co-founder of the Crips, as the far planet Pluto, which is 4,600,000,000 miles from the Earth. That is as far away from what he was as what he is.
Yes, check it. Yo, blue rage, black man in a cage in San Quentin. Animal in the jungle, language used against a brown man, against a black man. We got your back, stand. React to the fact, cause the Supreme Court let it stand. Raise up the appellate hand, yell it if you smell it, man. Tookie ain't no rookie, the cookie jaws got a racist hand. First we gotta save your life, then we gotta get you out. If we gotta wait you out, we may have to break you out.
Black and born, captive in the USA, raised in the wicked game people play. Struggle and pain is part of the insane ways of the ghetto, U.S. death row. But where the spirit flow, only the Lord knows. So we rhyming for freedom and justice to get the peacemaker off death row. It's a growing generation who need him to keep writing Tukey books, cause they need
an animal in his habitat rage. The lion cage, the court sway, the DA use metaphors this way. Soul snatchers be the prophets of rage. We on the front line and on the front page with who says,
I don't think so.
So as the people go about blind in their everyday lives, set up by those everyday lies, hope that they can drop a lie in a line as we remorse through the course of time and intercourse with the source of life.
The government's policy is hypocrisy. How can a person believe in a system, believe in the midst of the angst, making their decisions from high ranks, jeopardizing a life when anybody can buy faith?
The date is set as December the 13th. The mission is to execute the protocol for peace. The mission is to extinguish any brother helping deflect the violence in the system so the victims took the will.
Yo, so we can paint the picture to change and remake the scripture so people that ain't conflicted can listen and pay attention. But it's deeper than us, it's deeper than Wade shots, it's deeper than Jamie Foxx. We stuck in the same spot.
The number's 916-445-2841. Do me a favor, call Governor Schwarzenegger and let him know this rose in the concrete deserves to grow.
No. Way too many people in power positions living with hate in their minds. Some of them even think that they have the right to be taking the role of the Most High. When it comes to taking a black man's life, I wonder if they think twice. Would they rather us die than leave us alive in a 4x9-foot cell for life? How do they justify a homicide as a punishment for homicide? Retaliation's just an eye for an eye, right? So who are the thugs now that the power's changed hands? And the official who doesn't stand against them killing of this man?
From the holes of y'all ships, the crack of y'all whips, unloading of y'all clips, Vietnam and Iraq trips, black's been dying from the lying out of y'all lips. Right. So call it on on all blood and all Crips. Soon revolution gon' pop. It's gon' get this Ku Klux Klan, black man murder don't stop. Off top, we gon' ride by the millions. By the millions. Now every ex-slave say, say, stand Tookie Williams.
You are listening to Full Circle 94.1 KPFA. We are your hosts, Shayna and Chago. That was Free by The Frontline, The Soul Snatchers, Rico Pavón, and Cam.
And up next, De La Mana's own Courtney interviews her cousin, Jordan, who was recently released from a state prison in southern Florida.
Over 200,000 women are in prison and jail in the United States. More than 1 million are under criminal justice supervision. The number of women in prison has grown by over 800% in the past three decades. That's twice the rate of men. Two-thirds are there for nonviolent offenses, many of them drug-related.
Fyodor Dostoevsky once said, "The degree of civilization in a society can be judged by entering its prisons." Up next, Full Circle's Courtney Supple talks with her cousin Jordan, who gives us a glimpse of what one of America's maximum security correctional institutions is like.
Hi, Jordan. Thank you so much for joining us tonight on Full Circle.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for having me.
Can you begin by telling us where you were incarcerated and on what charges?
I was incarcerated at Broward County Correctional Institution in Florida as part of the Florida State prison system. My charges were sales, manufacturing, and delivery of heroin and cocaine.
And how long was your sentence?
24 months.
And how long did you serve?
21 months.
How did you end up at Broward? What was your path to this place like?
It started out, I'm sure, as every other human being that's addicted to drugs, smoking pot, drinking, getting into the hallucinogenics, and within a couple years I had progressed to shooting heroin and cocaine, and eventually I ended up in prison.
On the Department of Corrections website, it says that 20,000 people are incarcerated in the state of Florida for drug-related charges, making up 20% of the total incarcerated population. Approximately 2,100 of them are women, and more women are imprisoned for drug-related charges than for any other charge.
I believe it. Even some of the murders or armed robbery that I knew the girls committed was because of drugs. So not just possession charges, but everything else that goes along with that.
And do you feel like the prison that you were incarcerated in or any other prison that you have any knowledge of, do you feel like they have any sort of effective programs to deal with or address substance abuse and the related crimes?
I don't. There's a lot of hypocrites. It's like the girls walking around with Bibles who will shank their bunkie that night. They talk a good game, but they never bring it to fruition at all. They don't want to rehabilitate It's probably known the level of recidivism in prisons, but from the time I was there, I can't tell you how many girls I saw leave and come back while I was still there.
And were they usually coming back for the same charges that
yep.
they had been in prison for originally?
Yep. And most of it's all drug related. But I mean, the drug program I was in, the director was sleeping with one of the inmates in the program. The whole thing is so corrupt to me. I don't understand it at all.
What's the program you were in?
When I first got there, it was mandatory for me to go into the modality tier program. It was called, it's kind of like rehab inside a prison. But when I caught my DR and went to confinement, I lost my bed in that program. If you go to confinement for anything and you're there more than 10 days, you automatically lose your bed in that program.
How'd you catch your DR and end up in confinement?
The first time I went, I was guilty. I went for disrespect to an officer. During the summer in South Florida, the air conditioners weren't working in the dorms, and it was ungodly hot because you can't open the windows, and it's a big cement building which just holds in all the heat. So we were going and getting ice from the dining halls and bringing bags of it back to the dorm, and we would let every inmate get a cup of ice. Well, one night, the ice came. I was in line with my little cup to fill it up with ice, and this officer thought that I had already gotten ice. And I told her that I did not. And she was like, "F*** you, you're lying, get out of the line." I was like, "You know what, how about f*** you and f*** that ice?" At which point I was handcuffed and brought to confinement, and I stayed there for 30 days.
What's it like once you're in confinement?
Confinement pretty much sucks. You're allowed out on Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays for 10 minutes at a time. You're handcuffed and brought to the shower. You're placed in a shower that's got a cell door on it. They take the handcuffs off. You have 10 minutes to bathe, and then you're right back in your cell. You technically aren't allowed to get any books other than religious reading materials from the chapel, whatever the chapel has to offer. You can put in requests for these type of things. I think I got a book on Buddhism once, but that's about the coolest thing I ever got.
Yeah, I read that Broward, which is a state prison funded by taxpayers, emphasizes what they call faith and character-based correctional initiatives. Can you tell me more about your experience with religion at the prison?
Religion is taken very seriously by staff and inmates alike. When I first got there, you go through a transitional period called R&O, which stands for Reception and Orientation. And basically, you live there, and that's where you are told the rules, what you're allowed to wear, what you're allowed to do. They make you go to church every Sunday. At one point, a CO was trying to get me to take communion, and I told her that I didn't want to. She told me to just go up and stand in line and, like, cross my arms to, like, refuse it. And I was like, I'm not even going to stand in line. I shouldn't even be in this church right now. We didn't have an option. You had to go to church every Sunday. I tried to fight it, and I mentioned the whole separation of church and state, and this is against my personal beliefs. I'm an atheist. I shouldn't be made to go to church. And they told me that if I didn't go, I would go to confinement. And at that point, I didn't really know what confinement was, so I was kind of scared about it.
Were things always so oppositional between folks on either side of the bars?
It depends. I knew some people that were there for 25 years, and they've had relationships with some officers for that long. And other officers, they saw them come in and be trained and that kind of thing. And I know a lot of relationships where officers were sleeping with inmates, male and female alike, and bringing in contraband for inmates, sending money to inmates' accounts, things like that.
Can you talk a little bit more about the underground economy in the prison that you were staying at?
Sometimes either kitchen staff or COs were being paid by inmates' families, or if they were sleeping with an inmate, they would bring in boxes of contraband at a time, and it would be sold on the compound.
Who was profiting from this underground economy, and what kind of profits were they making?
Inmates were profiting. I know that they would make hundreds at a time, either with having whoever was buying it transfer money into their account or having that person shop in the canteen line for $65 a week, whatever it was, until it was paid off.
What kind of things were being bought and sold in this market?
Pretty much everything. Drugs and alcohol were very common, of course. And, I mean, even the simplest things like hair ties, better toothbrushes, lots of makeup, lots of cologne and perfumes, things that you just couldn't get there.
I'd like to talk a little bit about the health care that you received at Broward. According to the Department of Corrections website, it says that they provide comprehensive medical, dental, mental health, and pharmaceutical services, including health education, preventative care, and chronic illness clinics. Health care is provided at a constitutional standard of care as mandated by the federal government. Now, I know that you live with a chronic illness, hepatitis C. Do you feel like you received adequate care while you were incarcerated at Broward?
Healthcare there was pretty much a joke. I didn't get as much checkups as I should have when it comes to having my enzymes checked, especially because I was on antidepressant medication, and sometimes that makes your enzymes go up. I was maybe monitored 3 times in the 21 months that I was there.
And how often should you have been monitored?
Probably every 90 days would have been the standard.
And was this the same for emergency situations and acute care?
When I first got there, I had broken my hand. I went to medical, it's called. They gave me an ice pack for 10 minutes. They gave me 2 ibuprofen and sent me back to the dorm. The next morning, my hand was black on both sides, and I couldn't move it to write or anything. And I kept telling them, I think my hand is broken, I think my hand is broken. I went to medical again. The nurse looked at it. She said, it's not broken, you're fine. Sent me back to the dorm. 4 months later, I finally have an x-ray on the hand, and the x-ray tech said that it was broken. But at that point, it had already begun to heal improperly, and the only way for them to fix it would be to re-break it and set it. they sent me to an outside doctor. The outside doctor told me I'd be better off just letting it heal and let's see what happens was, I think, his exact words.
What were the facilities like? What were the physical conditions at Broward like?
Some dorms were better than others. There was a lot of rodent infestation in the kitchen area where the food was prepared and in the dining halls where the food was served. It wasn't uncommon to see a rat run across the floor while you were eating. A lot of times the water went out because of the pump slash well system they had. If it rained a lot, we couldn't use water because it was contaminated, so we couldn't bathe, we couldn't brush our teeth, we couldn't drink water, we couldn't do any of that. Especially during hurricane season, we would go on water restriction maybe 3 nights a week.
Sounds pretty terrible. I mean, from the First Amendment violations to the total disregard for your human right to health care to the squalid physical conditions, did prison change you?
Yes. I don't know if for the better or for the worse. And I feel bad for the girls. One in particular friend I had made one mistake, was a good girl. She went to prison, and she has cried to me because she's changed so much, because she's just cold-hearted and hardened now. She's not the same innocent person she was when she went 11 years ago. You send somebody to prison when they're 25 years old for 22 years, I don't think that's going to benefit her.
Yeah.
You know, after 22 years in prison, you're institutionalized.
Do you think that's pretty common? Do you think that's widespread, that most people who go into prison and live there for long enough become institutionalized?
Completely. And I've talked to girls, they wouldn't even know what to do when they got out because they're so used to being there, somebody telling you when to get up, when to go to bed, when to go to work, where to walk, that when you get out. I mean, when I got out and went to Walmart to get hygienes, I stood in the aisle and was completely lost because there was such a huge selection that it took a while for me to adjust.
Yeah, it's funny. You called them hygienes.
Yeah, see? Because I'm institutionalized. That's what they're called on Canteen. Hygiene.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I was only there for 21 months, so imagine someone's there for 21 years.
So you recently got released. Are you on probation?
I'm off. And one of the reasons for me even choosing prison was so I could just do my time and be done with it. Because in Florida, when they put you on probation, you are not meant to succeed. You're not meant to complete it successfully at all. You violate for being 5 minutes late to visit your PO. They violate you and put you right back in jail. And then you have a violation on top of your original charges. In fact, a lot of the women that are in prison are there for violation of probation. It may sound cynical, but I think it's all about money.
What do you mean it's all about money?
The state receives a certain amount of money for taxpayers for every person that's in prison. And when you're on probation, you need to pay all those probation fees. So you violate, they put you in, they extend your probation. If you violate again, they might extend it again, up the fees, and then finally they just put you in prison. It's a business.
It's a business. So, what are you doing now that you're out?
Now that I'm out, I have relocated to the mountains of North Carolina, and I manage a restaurant there. I love my job. I love the family that I work for. It's a family-owned business, and I feel like they're my family. And they love me, and I love them, and I couldn't really ask for anything more at this point.
Yeah, life sounds pretty good.
Yeah, life's pretty amazing.
That's awesome. So what are your hopes for the future?
Not to go to prison. That would be a good thing. Not to shoot drugs. Also a good thing. And really, I'm just working with my boss and her company, and we're going to try to either franchise it out or open another location in Greenville and possibly Charlotte.
Sounds like you have a lot coming in the future.
I do. I hope so.
That's really exciting.
I've waited a long time, so.
Thank you so much for sharing your story with us tonight, Jordan. I really appreciate it.
Oh, no problem, Courtney. Thank you.
Okay. I love you.
I love you too, honey. I'll talk to you soon.
Okay. Bye.
I wish I had. The secret I do and the secret I pass. Why does this question drive me mad? 'Cause I was taught when but a lad. Thought I was good and good was bad. Oh,
you, Courtney, for sharing that conversation with your cousin, Jordan. It was really, really amazing. For the listeners, if you want to learn more about how you can get involved in advocating for people incarcerated in America's prison system, you can visit Prison Activist Resource Center website at www.prisonactivist.org or give them a call at 510-893-4648. For national actions, try the Women's Prison Association at WPAonline.org.
So thank you for tuning in. You're listening to Shayna and Chago. We want to thank you for being a part of this dialogue here on Full Circle 94.1 KPFA. All right. So let's get into an interview by the Minister of Information, JR, of Block Report Radio. He interviews Mumia Abu-Jamal, who, on December 9th, will be in his 28th year locked up on death row, despite all the evidence that points to his innocence. JR speaks to him about his personal situation, as well as the trial of Oakland BART police officer Johannes Meserle, and the resignation of Van Jones from his White House position. JR reports.
After close to three decades, many of Mumia's supporters around the planet believe that he is closer than ever to being assassinated by lethal injection on Pennsylvania's death row. We are asking everyone within earshot of this broadcast to get involved in freeing this man and so many of our other warriors behind enemy lines. People like Rochelle McGee, Hugo Pinnell, Imam Jamil Alameen, and Aaron Patterson, to name a few. I did this interview with Mumia to talk about his own particular case, the change of venue for the trial of police trigger man Johannes Meserle, who murdered Oscar Grant on New Year's of 2009, and the resignation of Van Jones from the White House. Can you talk about your present-day situation? What are conditions like for you and others on Pennsylvania's death row currently?
Well, they're grim all over the United States. Death row is solitary confinement. That is, men are in their cells 22 and 2 if they choose to go out and go into the cage. That's 22 hours in the cell and 2 hours in a cage if you do go. If not, then it's 24 hours in your cell and alone. That is the situation that most men experience, because given the weather and whatnot, most men do not go out into the cage or yard. So you're by yourself all the time. And how you spend your time is based on how you want to spend it, in essence.
How does that affect you mentally?
Some men go mad. We've seen a spate of suicides in the last several months and weeks. Those who have heard me do pieces in the last several months recall the William Tilley case that I did a piece on several weeks ago. Did a case on a brother named Jose Pagan, or June. These were men who spent quite a few years on death row, and unexpectedly to all who knew them, by the next morning they had committed suicides. And I assure you, it is not easy to do in a solitary hookup, but they found a way to succeed.
Well, definitely, just let everybody know they got our support, and we definitely going to keep them in our thoughts and make sure we put this interview out as far as possible.
Good, man.
You know, are you informed about the venue change for Johannes Meserle, the trigger man and one of the police involved in the murder of Oscar Grant?
I am indeed. I can't say I was surprised, because if you've read about cases similar to that, I mean, you can go to New York and find the same thing. It's very interesting that police officers who serve in certain areas and cities and districts and counties and localities, shall we say, once they get charged with something, they can't wait to get out of that locality that they claim to serve. I mean, if you serve the locality, why not be tried there? You know, these are the people you quote-unquote serve, right? But not only do they petition for a change of venue, there are very few cases where that's refused. And often they go to, I mean, we don't have to go very far. You're California. You remember Rodney King.
Right.
But he went, what, from L.A. to Simi Valley, right?
Right.
Amadou Diallo in New York, the cops that shot him in his doorway, they went to Albany, I believe, you know, as far away from New York City and staying in the state. So What does that tell you about what they think of the people that they work amongst? Also, if you think about it, think about how the media treated Oscar and treats all the poor people and, you know, black people all across this country. You know, it's not a big story unless, and it would not have been a big story if people did not organize and protest and make it a big story. It
right. would have been rebel in the streets.
Exactly. It would have been one day's or 2 days news.
Right. What role do you think class plays when you look at the resignation of Van Jones from the White House and look at all the hoopla in the so-called progressive media that was defending this former nonprofit administrator and, in my opinion, social vampire? Van Jones denounced his earlier communist beliefs and became a part of the capitalist administration.
Well, if we're honest, class, of course, plays a very telling and important role in how, you know, people live their lives, how they think, how they interact, how they deal with others, of course. But when it comes to black folks in the United States, I think the most honest term is caste. A lot of people may disagree with that, but there is a difference, a profound difference between black people and other people. And it doesn't matter what role you function in. It doesn't matter if you're a lawyer, a scholar. I mean, look at Henry Louis Gates in his home. Now, if you analyze them by class, you would say the upper class, right? A professional class and all that. To the cop who came to his house, he was who was making too much
right,
noise.
But to a Barack Obama, he spoke out on it and didn't speak out on Oscar Grant.
That's what I mean about an illusion of class, because, you know, the history of the United States is so profoundly negrophobic or racist when it comes to black folks, that it doesn't matter what class you're in, because you can lose that so-called class advantage at the drop of a hat.
Thank you again, once again, and I definitely will be in contact with you.
Well, thank you too, Broham, and keep on keeping on. You're doing some hellified work, and give my love to the peeps on the move. Long live John Africa, and
free them all.
Keep on keeping on.
No doubt.
Free them all forever.
Yes, sir.
On the move, y'all.
You were just listening to the voice of death row political prisoner and prolific journalist Mumia Abu-Jamal as he talked about his own legal case, the venue change for murder trial police trigger man Johannes Messerly, and the resignation of Van Jones from the White House. This is the Minister of Information, J.R., on Block Report Radio. If you would like more information, you can go to www.blockreportradio.com. Until next time, what's the call? Free them all. We out.
Welcome back, everybody. You're listening to Full Circle, 94.1 KPFA FM. We are your hosts, Shayna and Chago. That was JR of Block Report Radio interviewing Mumia Abu-Jamal. To find out what folks are doing around prison activism locally and beyond, visit the National Police Accountability Project at www.nlg-npap.org.
All right, so let's finish tonight's show with Joy Moore's commentary on the growing prison industrial complex in the U.S. and how our tax dollars continue to support de facto slavery in the 21st century.
Whoop, whoop, that's the sound of the police. Whoop, whoop, that's the sound of the beast. Whoop, whoop, that's the sound of the police. Whoop, whoop, that's the sound of the beast. Whoop, whoop, that's the sound of the police. Whoop, whoop, that's the sound.
In this country, the prison system has become the first response to resolve far too many social problems that overwhelm people living in poverty-ridden communities across America. These social problems are concealed and grouped together and labeled crime and become, quote, criminal behavior by people with limited resource and education. Homelessness, unemployment, drug addiction, mental illness, and illiteracy are a few of the social problems that vanish from public view when the people struggling with these problems are relegated to the prison system. The so-called war on drugs has made people with limited resources, people of color, women, youth, and undocumented immigrants the primary targets of the prison industrial complex. The United States spends more on prisons and incarcerates more individuals than any other industrialized country in the world. According to one study, between 1971 and 1994, public spending on prisons alone jumped from $2.3 billion to $34.2 billion. Prison spending is growing at a faster rate than Medicaid and higher education. In 2004, funds to build prisons increased by $926 million, while funds for university construction declined by $954 million. Most of us know these facts, yet we let it continue. Our tax dollars are spent to destroy lives and families and whole communities. The condition of poverty and one's skin color are the factors that increase the odds of imprisonment. Most prisoners come from disadvantaged backgrounds. Most have not completed high school. Many can barely read. Roughly one-third were unemployed before imprisonment. Another third had annual incomes of less than $5,000. What does this prison industrial complex cost all of us? U.S. taxpayers spend more than $32 billion a year for prisons. Every year that an inmate spends in prison costs $22,000. An individual sentenced to 5 years for a $300 theft costs the public more than $100,000. The cost of a life term averages $1.5 million. States are spending more money on prisons than education. Over the course of the last 20 years, the amount of money spent on prisons has increased by 570%. 570%. While what's spent on elementary and secondary education has decreased rapidly. The prison industrial complex generates an estimated $40 billion each year. Correction Corporation of America is the largest private prison corporation in the world. American Express and General Electric invested in private prisons in the states of Oklahoma and Tennessee. AT&T, Sprint, MCI charge inmates and their families six times the normal cost of a long-distance call within the United States. And the list goes on. Chevron, the airline industry, and Victoria's Secret uses prison labor to complete data entry, book telephone reservations, and make lingerie at 23 cents an hour. The Federal Prison Industry Corporation uses inmates to make recycled furniture at $40 a month, working 40 hours per week. This is de facto slavery. The United States Bureau of Prisons is one of the world's largest slave labor industrial manufacturers who control the market in everything from vehicle parts to music speakers and missile wiring harness systems. Unicor, also known as the Federal Prison Industries, employs over 23,000 inmates with a reported profits of over $800 million a year. Contrary to what many may believe, slavery was not outlawed or abolished in the United States by the passage of the 13th Amendment. The 13th Amendment was not designed to abolish slavery completely, but to specify more clearly the circumstances under which slavery could continue. Therefore, a large number of African Americans and others have found themselves duly convicted and once again engaged in slave labor. What we now have are plantations with razor wire prison industrial complexes generating huge profits for many, many corporations. As the prison industrial complex grows in the United States, private capital has become a major partner in the punishment industry. And because of their profit potential, prisons have become an important part of the United States economy. African-American men are 6% of the U.S. population, but over 40% of their prison population. African-Americans are eight times more likely to be in prison than European-Americans. And alarmingly, the fastest growing prison population is women. California now has the distinction of having the most women prisoners in the nation, as well as the world's largest women's prison. Since 1980, the number of women imprisoned in the U.S. has tripled, and more than 70% of women inmates were incarcerated for nonviolent drug, property, or public order offenses. These female inmates are more likely than male inmates to have suffered serious physical or sexual abuse. A 2004 government study found that 73% of women in state prisons nationwide either had symptoms of mental illness and/or were receiving treatment from a mental health professional at the time of arrest. Over one-third of female inmates have either never been arrested or convicted of any crime prior to their current offense. The majority of women are in prison for economic crimes. Of the women convicted of violent crimes, the vast majority were convicted for defending themselves or their children from abuse. 54% of women in prison are women of color. 90% of women in prison are single mothers. There are at least 167,000 children in the U.S. whose mothers are incarcerated. The average age of women in prison is 29, and 58% have not finished high school. Racism and economic discrimination are inextricably linked to sexism in our culture, creating severe inequalities in the court and prison systems. For example, African-American women are twice as likely to be convicted of killing their abusive husbands than are European-American women. African-American women, on average, receive longer jail time and higher fines than do European-American women for the same crimes. The number of women in prison has increased 138% in the last 10 years. This is partly due to the worsening of economic conditions for women and also due to the increase in arrest rates due to the war on crime and war on drugs. The annual cost of corporate crime was estimated to be between $174 and $231 billion, while the economic cost of street crimes like burglary and robbery was only $3.4 billion. We must look at why the state focuses on enforcing laws which penalize the actions taken by poor and working class men and women, while systematically ignoring the more destructive white collar crimes. While researching and compiling these facts for this piece, I was almost overwhelmed by the sheer enormity of this monster called the prison industrial complex. We should call it what it really is, slavery. And what can we people do about it, you may ask? Well, we must be an organized, vocal, agitating, resistant movement. We must remain diligent and persistent and ever mindful of this growing injustice. All of us already working to reverse this social injustice must redouble our efforts, and all of the rest of us have to get involved. Become social justice activists. Write your lawmakers, organize your church or community group, reach out to and support young people, and welcome and assist people as they come out of these prisons. Support an existing organization working with prison reform and prisoner advocacy, and make your voice heard loud and often. Finally, we could and should all pray for the inmates and their families who suffer the injustice of this criminal system. Only together can we make a difference. This is Joy Moore with KRS-One in the background, a Full Circle.
Thank you, Joy, for fanning that flame of humanity with your perspective on the industry of prison. And we want to thank all y'all who tuned in tonight. The topic of tonight's show may have been hard to hear, but it's important to recognize how the strength and sometimes invisible power of the prison industrial complex paralyzes and decimates our communities, locking up family members and friends, all for the purpose of turning enormous profits. But we're happy that you decided to join this discussion tonight, and definitely invite your feedback. Feel free to email us at fullcircle@kpfa.org.
Yeah, and we also want to remind everyone that if you did miss last week's show, it was an excellent show on health, a lot of important information. You can check it out in the archives at www.kpfa.org. We also want to remind everyone, as we do have for the last couple months, that we're still accepting applications for the First Voice Apprenticeship Program. The deadline for applications is January 29th, and we encourage everyone to not only apply, but also spread the word. Both myself and Chago are thriving, inspired, happy members of Group 34. And if you apply, nice. You could possibly become part of that next generation of Group 35. So definitely check out some information. You can check out our website, firstvoicemap.org. And I want to let you know this process, it's definitely just as much about building a community as it is really learning the nuts and bolts of radio production and all the technological aspects. We've been doing this for about 8 months. We've learned everything from operating the boards, interviewing skills. And like I said, you know, there's so much about bringing together people from really, really different communities, building trust, building understanding, building respect, and building a community.
And just the privilege and the honor to be able to capture the stories, hear the voices of the folks that we don't get to hear on the regular, you know. And this KPFA, the Full Circle program, we give nothing but love for this opportunity, this outlet that we have to share with you all.
And I know for me, too, that it definitely has been an opportunity to get out in my community and really investigate parts that I really never got to know before I had a mic in my hand. And it definitely empowered me to really ask tough questions and begin a process of connecting with people that were from places that were really different than from where I'm from. And I definitely have appreciated that experience.
And you know, like tonight, it just helps us reflect, like, something about the state-legislated murder of Stanley Tukey Williams on December 13th. December 12th, I don't know if you all recognize that, you know, it's a holy day for a lot of, like, indigenous people of Mexico. And state-legislated, like, events, like an execution to align with holy days, you know, it happens. So, now, just take a deep breath, and I want to wrap up by letting you know about our brother, Deuce Eclipse, who's got an event going on with Bang Data, his band, Bang Data. They're celebrating their debut, the debut of their album, Maldito Carnaval. And if you want tickets, we're giving them away for their record release party. That's this Thursday, December 17th, at the Paradise Lounge, 1501 Folsom Street at 11th in San Francisco. To the first caller number one, hit us up. We got a pair of tickets, all right? And if you don't get those tickets, then you can just pay $10 at the door. And with that price of admission, you also get a free CD. So you get a free CD regardless. Just hit us up, 848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. Let's get that first caller and you get this pair of tickets.
And that brings us to the end of tonight's show. Tune in next week to Full Circle at 7 o'clock right here on KPFA 94.1. Our website is www.firstvoicemap.org. And you can also check out our archive shows on www.kpfa.org.
And special thanks to our production and technical interns from Group 34 Telemana, the First Voice Media Action Program, Lamont, Kinshasa, Sukari, Courtney, Shauna Ray, Mwangi, Lindsay, and Jane. And a big thanks to Joy Moore for her contribution to tonight's show.
Our executive producers are RG and Miss M. Our technical director is Frank Sterling.
And our outro music is produced by Source of Labor. And that was our intro, and our outro is by B. Tondre.
If you have any questions or topics for future shows, definitely give us a call. We're open to your feedback. Call us at 510-848-6767, extension 627, or email us at fullcircle@kpfa.org.
With Jumbo Jane holding down the controls, we've been your hosts, Shayna and Chago. Thanks for joining us tonight on Full Circle. Now let's go out with some Bang Data, El Pacino. Stay tuned for La Onda Bajita.
Learning the art of listening? Listening is an essential skill to know when producing a quality radio show. The First Voice Apprenticeship Program, a community-sponsored radio station, KPFA 94.1 FM in Berkeley, can help satisfy your burn to learn the latest techniques being used in the world of radio broadcasting. First Voice is a comprehensive, hands-on, 18-month training program open to the community. Qualified applicants will learn all aspects of radio production, while actually working as a staff member of a weekly run radio show. Women, people of color, and members of communities that are traditionally underrepresented in media are encouraged to apply. For more information, contact the First Voice Apprenticeship Program at area code 510-848-6767.